Before I jump into the video, I want to encourage you to check out the description box below. I've included information and ways you can support Black Lives Matter and various other organizations. There are several ways you can help, whether it's via donation, signing a petition, sending an email, participating in a readathon, supporting Black creators, businesses, authors. These are all things I've been doing while I took a break from uploading videos and writing blog posts last week and will continue to do. I'm also going to start putting an asterisk next to the books by authors of color that I mention in my videos. I know there are a lot of authors out there who are people of color that I may not know. Please do correct me in the comments if you notice one I missed or mislabeled. So in the month of May, I read a total of 28 books. I participated in one readathon. I ended up DNFing 3 books this month, and I didn't reread any books. As for the type of books that I read, I ended up reading 7 ebooks, 2 physical books, and 19 audiobooks. I had 0, 1, and 2 star books, which is not unusual because usually if I'm gonna rate a book 1 or 2 stars, I usually just end up DNFing it instead, and then I don't rate DNFs. I had 8 3 stars, 8 4 stars, and 12 5 stars. I'm gonna start with the books that I ended up DNFing. The first one that I ended up DNFing was pretty disappointing because I was really looking forward to this one. It was Real Men Knit by Quanah Jackson. I received this as an e-arc from NetGalley. This one is a contemporary romance about a woman whose mother figure passed away, and she also happened to be the adoptive mother of, I think it's 3 or 4 men, and she owned a knitting shop. And all of the brothers want to shut down the knitting shop and just kind of get rid of it, except for one. So he enlists the help of his childhood friend. It was just really slow moving, and also I just could not get into it. I found myself skimming the book, and I decided just to DNF it. The other book that I DNF'd ended up being Becoming Mrs. Lockwood by K.A. Lynn. I talked about this one in my 7-year-old Picks My TBR video. It's basically about this girl who goes on vacation with her mom to Las Vegas, and her mom ignores her the entire time, so she's not able to go out and see the sights. She's kind of just stuck in her hotel, and then she meets this older guy, and they pretty much have like insta-love. This book is like 500 plus pages long, yet it was insta-love. The other thing that kind of bothered me about it was the fact that she's 18 years old, she's still in high school, and she doesn't act very mature, but for some reason he immediately falls for her anyway. He immediately finds out when they meet that she's still in high school, so that's just kind of, it weirded me out a little bit. The last book that I DNF'd was another contemporary-a-thon read, and it's a novella called Taming Her Mountain Man. It's Bearstooth Mountain Number 1 by Cameron Hart. This is a book about a girl who runs away from her creepy adoptive parents to her estranged grandmother's cabin on a mountain, and she ends up meeting this loner mountain man, and that's kind of why I wanted to read this book. It's super short, it's a novella, and also because I'm a big fan of like the loner trope. This is also an age gap romance as well, but similar to Becoming Mrs. Lockwood, this main character was very immature, and he was so much older than her that it wasn't believable. I feel like for me, in age gaps, whoever is the younger one has to be mature for their age for it to be believable for me. And it was just, it was super insta-lovey, which I expect from these type of novels, but it didn't reel me in like some of the other novellas that I had read did, so I just gave up on that one. So now I'm going to go into my star ratings, and as always, I like to rank all the books that I read during the month. It's really hard to do this, but I like doing it. It's a challenge for myself. So I always start with the book that I liked the least and go up to my favorite read of the month. So the first 3-star read that I had was Remind Me, Magnolia Sound, book number 1 by Samantha Chase. I borrowed this book from Hoopla, which is my library's audiobook service. And this one is just one that I randomly listened to off of Hoopla. It's a second chance contemporary romance that kind of takes place in a small town. It's your stereotypical like small town romance where the girl lived in a small town and then she moved away. But she has this relationship with a guy who lived next door to her grandfather, who she's very close with. and she ends up moving away to New York to pursue her dreams. And she's actually pretty big and successful in the tech world, which is cool. But there's a hurricane coming and her grandfather is refusing to leave. So the guy that lived next door, he ends up staying with her grandfather for her. And so she ends up flying down to check on them after the hurricane. So one thing to mention is I live in Florida. I have lived through many hurricanes, some really big scary for hurricanes and some that ended up not being too scary. One thing I can say is when there's a mandatory evacuation, you freaking leave. Like, don't stay. So that kind of annoyed me. I mean, I get that he's an older man and it's hard to reason with them, but that whole part of it, I was just like, dude, leave. Like, it can completely wipe out neighborhoods. She goes back after the hurricane and then she ends up reconnecting with him. And it was fine. It was just fine. It was nothing special and very forgettable. Next is The Royal Treatment. It's Alaskan Royal Family, book number one by Mary Janice Davidson. Mary Janice Davidson is the writer of the Undead series. I talked about her in my Books That Got Me Over My Twilight Hangover video. I happened to see this one, I think, on Audible Escape, but I just wanted to read it because I was curious about how her contemporary romances are as opposed to paranormal romances. This one, again, was fine. Like, it's in this alternate universe, and I think it's like in the future, but not like far in the future. It's like 2030 or something, but Alaska is its own kingdom, and so they have a king. That was super weird to me. I'm like, just like make up country. Why does Alaska have to be a country? In this country, the king is looking for a bride for his son, who is the prince, and he comes across this girl, I think they're on a boat or something, and is very sassy, and he likes that about her, so he arranges their marriage. And it was interesting because with her relationship with the prince, there was attraction, but it wasn't like insta-lust or insta-love even. They were slightly attracted to each other all the way up until they got married, and then it started developing into something, and I thought that was very interesting and very different, but it still wasn't anything amazing. So next is P.S. It's Always Been You, Part 1 by Lauren Blakely. This I listened to on audio from Audible Escape. I listened to it for Weekend Contemporary Marathon, and I talk more about it there. This is part one, I think, of four super, super short audiobooks. That's why I picked it up. It's only 2 hours long, so I finished it like very quickly. And the main reason why I picked it up is because Scott Eastwood narrates it, and I was curious because he has a really nice speaking voice, and he does, but he's just kind of awkward when he narrates. He takes breaths in weird places. I don't know. But so that was kind of disappointing. And the book itself was just kind of meh. Part one through four probably could have been an entire book, but I didn't care enough by the time I finished this to finish the rest of the series. It's a second chance romance, and it's about this guy who stars in this survivor-ish TV show, like adventure survivor type TV show, and a woman who is some sort of historian. The two of them have like this fling, and he ends up leaving without a trace and goes and gets famous, but then they end up having to work together later. Nothing happened in it. Like, that was it. You don't even have to read the book because I just told you the entire book because it's broken up into four parts. There wasn't enough time to get invested in the characters or in their relationship or anything. I was just like, why though? Next, I read Abducting Abby, Dragon Lords of, what is this called? Valadir, book number one by S.E. Smith. Clearly, I was super in the mood for a Fated Mates book when I picked this one up. This is, I believe, on Audible Escape. It's either on Audible Escape or it was on Hoopla, I can't remember. So this one was actually pretty interesting. So it was fairly short, and it's about this girl who is an artist, and she's like kind of the loner who lives in a cabin in the mountains, and she's an artist. One day she discovers a alien spaceship that has crash landed in the woods by her house, and it's a dragon shifter that's in there. She doesn't realize it, but she ends up rescuing him and saving him, and it's like a fated mates thing. In order to protect her and save her, he takes her and a couple of her friends to his planet. I actually found that I really liked the friends that were in it, and I'm actually very intrigued to move on in this series because the romance that's kind of developing between her friend and his brother was really interesting. That one's going to be a hate to love, so I'm pretty excited to move on in this series, and it was good. I mean, it's no Ice Planet Barbarians, but it's good. So speaking of Ice Planet Barbarians, I also read Fire in His Blood. That is Fireblood Dragon, book number one by Ruby Dixon. Ruby Dixon is, of course, the author of Ice Planet Barbarians. And in this particular book, it's like a post-apocalyptic dragon shifter, like sci-fi fated mates romance. This too is not as good as Ice Planet Barbarians. The romance was good in this one too, My only complaint about this one was that it was a little too long. I felt like this story could have been just as short as her Ice Planet Barbarians books and it would have been fine. But I've also had just finished reading a bunch of super short books, so that could probably be part of it. But anyway, what I really did like about this one was this happens in Ice Planet Barbarians too, when there is a communication barrier. So they speak different languages and they have to communicate in other ways. And then it all gets sorted out in the end, so they're able to communicate. But what was really nice about it and that I took note of, even though they were fated mates, and in his mind, he has like an animalistic side to him. Obviously, he's a dragon shifter. And in his mind, she is his. But to her, she's like, who the heck are you? Like, this is weird. Despite him not being able to communicate and not being able to understand what she's saying, and despite him feeling like he has ownership over her, he still understood consent. If an alien dragon shifter can understand consent, why can't you, Brock? The next book that I read was Racked and Stacked. It's Blacktop Cowboys, book number 9 by Lorelei James. I think you can read these books as standalones. However, I will say the beginning of this book was a little bit confusing to me because I think there was a history between these two characters that maybe was built up in the previous books. I read this book for a secret TBR that I will be doing shortly. So this is obviously a cowboy romance. It's a hate to love romance. It has a lot of banter. It's a rom-com. The only thing that wasn't great about this one was, first of all, that I felt like I was being thrown into the relationship in the middle of it. He ends up taking care of her. So if you like the caretaking aspect of books, you'll probably like this one. He takes care of her because she injures herself and she has no one else to take care of her. Like, she moves in with her brother, but she's like sleeping on the couch. And so he ends up kind of reluctantly coming and taking care of her instead and bringing her back to his house. So that was really cute. Some of the humor didn't really hit with me. It was almost a little bit too slapstick funny in some places, but other places it was really funny. So yeah, I enjoyed that one, but 3 stars. Next is another ARC that I got from NetGalley, and it's a book that I was very excited about. It's Something to Talk About by Meryl Wilsner. It's Berkeley's first female-female romance. Very awesome for the author. It's a super slow burn romance about this movie. I think she's either a producer or director, I can't remember, and her assistant. They get caught in like a compromising position at an awards show, and everyone thinks that they're dating. So I thought there was going to be more of a fake dating element in it, and there wasn't really. It was kind of them trying to deal with the publicity of that. I love me a slow burn. I like a super long slow burn. Give me all the Mariana Zapata in the world. I am here for it. But for some reason, this one was too slow. Like, it was even too slow for me, and that's saying a lot. So by 70-75% of the book, they still hadn't kissed yet. And on one hand, that's excruciating. On the other hand, there were a lot of moments that I think were supposed to be very full of tension. I think it was something about the main character, the director. She was almost too cold and almost too indifferent. So it lost a little bit of that for me. I wish there was a little bit more chemistry between the two of them. Also, I think another thing that I didn't quite love about it is I'm not a big fan of books that have to do with fame, and I'm just not into the Hollywood thing. Next is a book that I read for Contemporary-a-thon. I talk about it in my Contemporary-a-thon vlog, which I will link down below. It is Shy Girls Write It Better, Some Girls Do It, number 1 by Mae Sage. This one, I really, really liked the premise of it. I was very excited about it. This is another super short one. It's available on Audible Escape, by the way. This is about a woman who writes erotic romance, and she also works for this company, and she ends up accidentally leaving her manuscript in a folder and giving that folder to her boss's boss instead of the report that she's supposed to give him. And he already kind of has the things for her, so when he reads it, he's very intrigued. And apparently she can't write BDSM scenes very well because she doesn't have experience with it, and so he has it in his mind that he's going to teach her so that she can write it better or whatever. And that had the potential to be not great. It had the potential for him to be like super cocky alpha guy, but he really wasn't, which was very refreshing. That kind of took me by surprise, and I really liked that. His mom also made an appearance in the book, and she could have easily been like, oh, you're not good enough for my son. Like, that's what you would expect, but she wasn't like that either. So it was nice. I liked that the character surprised me. All right, and we are on to our 4-star reads of the month. First one is Point of Retreat, Slammed book number 2 by Colleen Hoover. Slammed was a book about I think it's an age gap, and it's a teacher-student relationship, but I think they're in college. And it also revolves around slam poetry, which is why it's called Slammed. And I actually didn't even realize that there was a second book in this series until I came across it. And this was a short book, so I ended up reading it for Contemporary-a-thon. And I was hesitant going into this book. I mean, it's Colleen Hoover, so I kind of figured it was going to be good, but I wasn't sure if it was a story that I even needed to be told. I thought that the first book wrapped up fine, but it turns out there was enough more about this couple that needed to be told than there was in the first book. Apparently, there's a third book in the series, too. So, next on this list, I actually have the physical books for. I have two of them. It is Flame in the Mist by Renee Adier. This one I read as part of my 7-year-old picks my TBR. Rory picked out this book for me and is interesting because it's a very fantastical fantasy Mulan retelling. This book is just as badass as the cover is. And I talk more about this in that video, The 7-Year-Old Picks My TBR, but I really, really did enjoy this book. It was really beautifully written and very unique and very empowering. Next is another ARC that I got from NetGalley. It's The Marriage Game by Sarah Desai. I believe this is an Own Voices novel as well. And this one was a super fun enemies to lovers romance. And our main character has a big family with a lot of personality in it. And she has a really strong relationship with her dad, which I am always here for. Essentially, what happens is she moves away from New York because she just broke up with her ex-boyfriend who's like this influencer. He ended up like recording her for a YouTube video when she was like throwing his stuff out of the apartment, and then her employer fired her for it. So she ends up moving back home with her parents who own a restaurant. And on top of the restaurant, they have this office space, and she wants to be an entrepreneur. So her dad sets her up with the office above his building. What she doesn't realize is he has also set her up on an online dating community for an arranged marriage. So she ends up getting a visitor by these random guys who want to marry her. But at the same time, in this office where she moves into, her father has also rented the office to a CEO of a company that like fires a bunch of people at other companies. So she moves up into that office thinking it's all hers, and then he comes in. They clash quite a bit. I tend to like my enemies lovers romances where they aren't constantly thinking about and talking about how attractive the other person is, and that's kind of what this book does, which is why I took away a star. I usually like when the attraction builds. It almost takes the characters by surprise, but he is constantly thinking about how attractive she is and everything. And I'm just like, it got a little bit eye roll worthy after a while. Next is my monthly Brittany C. Cherry book. It's The Fire Between High and Low. That's Elements book number 2. This is a series that can be read completely as standalones because I don't even know how the series intertwines at all. I read this one for, I think it's Contemporary-a-thon. Pretty sure I read it for Contemporary-a-thon, did I? So I talk about this book in that video, but this book had a really great meet cute in it. I'm not going to say what it is because you should just read it and see how cute it is. But it's a friends to lovers romance, like all Brittany C. Cherry books that I've read anyway, very emotional. In this particular book, the hero is living in a terrible situation. His mother is a drug addict, his father is abusive to her and to him. He is dealing with drugs and has a drug problem, and really the only bright spot in his life is the heroine. This one probably is my least favorite Brittany C. Cherry, and it has nothing to do with the book itself or the story or how it was told. It has all the amazing things that Brittany C. Cherry books have. However, it was just the drug aspect that I didn't love. It's just not something I like to read about. It's totally a personal preference, so I still recommend this book because not everyone has that kind of preference that I do. Next is another novella that I read for Contemporary-a-thon. It's Mind Reader by Kirsty McManus. This book was such a fun premise. It's about a guy who can tell people's soulmates and when they're going to meet them, and he's making a decent living off of it. And then the girl is in the STEM field. I think she works for a stem cell research company. She does not believe that he actually knows what he's doing. And at first, I was a little put off by it because it's told from the hero's point of view. He's super cocky jerk. in the first couple of chapters. And I was like, oh my gosh, I'm not gonna be able to get through this. It ended up turning into a super sweet romance, like super cute. And I really had expectations and predictions in my head of how it was going to end up. And it didn't really end up doing any of the things I thought it was gonna do. I was pleasantly surprised, but also a little bit disappointed because I was looking forward to some of those things that I made up in my head. But it was still really good. And especially if you're looking for a short novella that isn't super steamy, like it had Fade to Black scenes in it. So if that's something that you lean more towards, then I highly recommend this book. Next up is The Worst Best Man by Mia Sosa. I believe this is Own Voices for the Latinx Rep. Not 100% sure, but I think it is. And it's a romantic comedy between a woman who has been left at the altar and the best man, who is the groom's brother. It's their romance. I really liked this book. I feel like I heard a lot of people talking about this book and they didn't really like it, but I ended up really, really enjoying it. I thought it was really funny. I liked her whole family. She got fired from her job for being too emotional. And that drives me crazy. That plays a big part in how she handles herself now. So she's very, very reserved now and tries not to be too emotional about things because she thinks it's going to ruin her career, ruin her life. And then he feels like he can never live up to everyone's expectations of him because of his brother. He feels like he's constantly being pitted against his brother. There was like that serious aspect in it and dealing with those type of things, which I really liked, but then it was really funny too. Next on this list is Girl Gone Viral. This is Modern Love book number 2 by Alicia Ray. It's a bodyguard romance. This is another one that a lot of people, I feel like, have said that they didn't like, and I really liked it. So not only was it a bodyguard romance, but it had a ton of longing in it, and I am so here for the longing. So the heroine in this, she is an ex-model and a widow, and she also is dealing with severe panic disorder, and it was a fantastic representation. When you have anxiety disorder, if you have panic attacks, usually you have either a safe place, but sometimes that safe place can be a safe person, and her safe person was the bodyguard, and I just can't. Like, it was so adorable. Yeah, so she's this ex-model, and she's kind of in hiding, and she ends up having this interaction with this guy at a coffee shop that ends up getting live tweeted by this couple that she doesn't even realize is there. And it ends up going viral. And that's scary for her because she's supposed to be in hiding, so her bodyguard kind of whisks her away to his hometown. So then it's like a forced togetherness type of situation, and he's her bodyguard, and there's a lot of longing. I will say the only reason why I took away a star is because there was so much great tension and buildup, and it had a lot of great elements, but when they finally got together, it kind of fell flat a little bit for me. That was the only kind of meh thing about this book, but I do highly, highly recommend it. I really, really liked this book. I'm so excited about this next one. So this next one is Desolate. It's Grace, book number 1 by Autumn Gray. And Autumn Gray is one of those authors who I am determined to read every single book on her backlist. A lot like Brittany C. Cherry, except that Autumn Gray doesn't have as many books on her backlist, so I have to kind of pace myself and not binge everything she's ever written. I didn't even read the synopsis for this book before I read it because I didn't have to. I had a feeling I was gonna love it. I love her writing. She's a gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous writer. She's similar to Brittany C. Cherry in that her books tend to be pretty emotional. I love her characters, especially her heroes. So this one, it's this guy who wants to become a priest, and he's wanted to become a priest ever since he was very young. He lost both of his parents, and then I think he lives with his uncle. I think it's his uncle, and his uncle is a priest. So now he aspires to be a priest, to be like his uncle, because his uncle is a great man. So that's all he's wanted to do since he was 13. But also when he was 13 is when he met the heroine. Kind of has always been very curious about her. There's always been this connection between them. And then it fast forwards to when they're a little bit older and they're like 18 or so. Something ends up bringing them together and they end up forming a friendship, and he is so conflicted by how he feels about her and also how he wants to dedicate his life to God. And as a Catholic priest, you are not supposed to have relationship at all. So it's this war that he's fighting with himself. It was so, so good, but I had to take away the star only because it ends on a cliffhanger. It is part of a trilogy. All of the books are out. I will be reading the rest of them. I started feeling a little disappointed in the hero, and I had loved him so much in the beginning, but I started feeling disappointed in him because I was like, make up your mind. Like, he was driving me a little bit crazy. I'm like, if you love her that much, then be with her. If you don't, then like don't be with her, like let her go, stop stringing her along. So I don't know, I'm very interested to read the rest of the series and see how it ends and how everything ends up working out. All right, we are on to my 5-star reads. So the first book is Sick Kids in Love by Hannah Moskowitz. I'm pretty sure I saw that Hannah Moskowitz was tweeting some problematic things. I think she issued an apology. I don't know how good the apology was. I didn't actually read any of the tweets. I just had seen some subtweeting about it. So keep that in mind. As someone who has multiple sclerosis, which is a chronic illness, it was so refreshing to see it reflected in this YA contemporary romance and done so well. I think its own voices. I'm pretty sure Hannah Moskowitz has chronic illness. Not only was the romance sweet and everything you would expect from a YA contemporary romance, the way that they spoke about chronic illness just completely hit home. The way they talked about having healthy friends and having to deal with being surrounded by healthy people, but you not being healthy yourself and not being healthy enough to do the things that these healthy people take for granted. And just the way that they spoke about that, mostly it was just the chronic illness rep was so, so good. So the next two are both Winston Brother books. I am slowly working my way through this series by Penny Reed. The first one that I read last month was Grin and Beard It. It's book number 2. This one so far has been my least favorite that I read, but still really good. I gave it 5 stars, obviously. And the only reason why I consider it my least favorite is because it did have the whole fame element in it. Only this time the heroine was the one who is famous. She is this plus size comedic actress, and she's also a director and a writer. She's super talented, super charismatic. And then the hero has a troublesome past, like he got into trouble in his past, but he's like worked on himself and has changed for the better. But he's also super charming as well, like a charming gentleman. And they end up meeting because she gets lost trying to read a map, and he ends up like rescuing her and taking her where she needs to be. And then they end up having this really cute meet cute and great banter and great chemistry, but he doesn't know her, like he doesn't recognize her, but everyone else in the town does. And she's only in this small town because they're filming a movie, and she's so refreshed by the fact that he doesn't recognize her that she doesn't tell him at first. It was interesting. It was an interesting take on the famous element, and it was cute. So then the next book is the third book in the Winston Brothers series. It's Beard Science, and I'm pretty sure this is like universally the favorite book in the Winston Brothers series, although my favorite is still Truth or Beard. But this one is about Cletus. He's the quirky, super smart, a little bit mischievous brother of them all. I don't remember where he is in the age range though. I was very interested going into this one because I wanted to know who someone like that would end up with, and it was not what I expected. So the heroine in this is a woman who still lives with her parents and is very much under her parents' thumb. She works at the bakery that her parents own, but they really don't do anything. She does all the work. She works 7 days a week. She works her butt off. But the entire town knows her as this naive little prissy, constantly completely made up, hair perfect, wearing heels and a cute little dress all the time girl. But that's not who she truly is. It's who her mother has molded her into being. And she has kind of lost sight of who she is and who she wants to be until her and Cletus end up crossing paths and working together a little bit. And he kind of brings her out of her shell. And he honestly has seen her the way the entire town sees her and doesn't think that she's at all his type, until he slowly starts realizing that he's attracted to her. And that's exactly the type of romance that I like. So this next book, I can't believe is so high up on my list, but I can't lie. It's Power Tools Collection Number 1, Power Tools Books 1 and 2 by Jane Rylan. This is super steamy, super short, 2 novellas that are reverse harem. I loved this book because though it was ridiculous, it has a really, really, really strong romance. The first book had a very summery feel, like you could feel, like as you're reading, you're feeling the sweltering heat and all of this stuff. But then the second book had a very autumny feel, so you could feel like the cool weather, and just the setting was so atmospheric. This is a short, steamy reverse harem novel, and she was able to develop this relationship better than like a 500 page book that I've read has developed a relationship. And it was a reverse harem, and it was ridiculous situations, but the romance was so strong and the atmosphere was so good. I really, really, really highly recommend this series. I think if you're looking to get into reverse harem, but you still want a strong romance in it, I think this is a really good series. Next 5-star read is The Madness of Lord Ian Mackenzie by Jennifer Ashley. I finally found a historical romance that I freaking love. There are only a handful, and eventually I will do a video once I have a couple of more, but oh my gosh, I'm obsessed with this book. This was actually a recommendation from a subscriber who mentioned it in a comment, and as soon as I heard what this book was about, I immediately went and got it and listened to it on audiobook, and then ended up having to have a physical copy. The hero in this, Lord Ian Mackenzie, has autism. He's on the spectrum, but back then they didn't know what that was and they just thought he was crazy. That's why it's called The Madness of Lord Ian Mackenzie, and he was treated horribly for it. He was essentially tortured, like had to get electric shock treatments and all sorts of stuff because he was basically a savant. Like, he could listen to a song and immediately play it, but he couldn't read music, and he also couldn't read emotions well. I loved him because he was such a misunderstood character, but like, knowing what I know, I understood why he was the way he was. And then you have the heroine, who is the first woman who ever really understood him. And she is a widow, and her husband left her with a lot of money, so she isn't worried about trying to marry somebody who can give her a lot of money. She is also not a virgin, so she's not your virginal heroine. She knows what she wants, and she goes after it unapologetically. Freaking loved her. But what I loved the most about it was that she understood him. She was one of the only people who understood. And there's this one scene, he's playing the piano, and he's playing the super sad song. She's like, "Can you stop playing that? Because it's making me upset. Like, can you play something happy?" And he's like, "I'm sorry, like, I don't know what is considered happy. I don't really understand emotions in that way." And he's like, "Can you just pick one for me?" And it was just, it tore at my heartstrings so much. But this book was so good. I loved it so freaking much. I recently listened to Hamilton, The Revolution by Lin-Manuel Miranda. And this freaking book, it was so good. Now, Dear Evan Hansen is my favorite musical, but Hamilton is right up there with it. I have seen Dear Evan Hansen. I have not seen Hamilton. I have watched performances. I have listened to the music, but it is coming out on July 3rd, and it was amazing. I listened to it in a day, and I became even more obsessed. It's basically just telling the story of how Hamilton came to be and how Lin-Manuel Miranda is basically a freaking genius. It goes into the intricacies of how they chose the costumes, the choreography, basically how they took these white historical figures and completely diversified it to reflect the New York of now as opposed to the New York of then. And how they took a musical genre that is not often associated with Broadway and put it into a musical. It's just amazing. It's amazing. And the things that they did for the school system, create a whole program to where students can go and learn about Hamilton and see themselves reflected on the stage. It's so powerful. Such a good book. If you love Hamilton, and honestly, even if you don't, highly recommend you read this book. Next 5-star is Love Her or Lose Her, Hot and Hammered, book number 2 by Tessa Bailey. This book I was very nervous going into because a lot of people had said that the hero in this is way too alpha, and I've heard multiple people say that, and I already am not a big fan of alpha heroes. But let me tell you something, I was living for this alpha hero. I also don't typically like second chance marriage books, but I've been proven wrong by the Bromance Book Club and this book. This is about a couple who has really great sexual chemistry, but really bad communication. However, the husband, the hero, he doesn't realize it because sexual chemistry is so good and all that part of it is good. It's almost the opposite of the Bromance Book Club. That was a very interesting dynamic because the wife had to finally stand up for herself and be like, "This is not enough for me." And I get where people were saying that he was too alpha because he was very much like, "I should provide for you and, you know, that's my duty as a husband." I didn't find that. I mean, he was overbearing in some ways, but he wasn't like a jerk alpha. He did it completely out of love. What I really, really love and respected from this book was how they spoke about love languages and how you are supposed to communicate your love depending on what your partner needs. And that was the main thing that was wrong in their relationship, was they had two totally different languages but were communicating in what they were hoping to receive. Very, very interesting. And there was so much longing in this book. I got so many butterflies from this book. I loved it so much. The next up is a super hyped read, but it is hyped for a good reason. It is Beach Read by Emily Henry. This book is so amazing. So I ended up receiving this from NetGalley, from the publisher. This is one of those books that I went into expecting to love it, and I did. I feel like the cover makes it seem like it's a very light and fluffy rom-com. And while it does have the rom-com element in it, in fact, it's freaking hilarious in some spots. I laughed out loud. I underlined so many things in this book because it was so freaking funny. This book has a lot of heavy topics in it. We're dealing with loss, with grief, with resentment, really, really heavy, heavy, very sad topics woven in between this super strong romance and this romantic comedy element in it. I'm sure you've heard a lot about this book and a lot of people rave about this book, so I'm not going to go too far into it, but just know, freaking love this book. It's my second favorite book of the month. So the only book, and it's actually three books, but it's all part of the same series and I read them back to back to back. I can't really distinctly separate them, so I'm just gonna lump them together as my favorite read of the month, is The Edge series by C.D. Race. This actually has five books in it. I read 0.5, book one, and book two. So I feel like the prequel to this is 100% absolutely necessary to the rest of the series because it establishes the relationship between the couple that is in this entire series. So it makes you, despite everything that they go through, and they go through a lot in the rest of the series, it makes you fight so hard for them and really, really want them to be together. Because in the first book, it takes place in the middle of a war zone. It's a psychiatrist who is treating all of the soldiers and the surgeons who are having to choose one life over another to save because there are too many bodies coming in. And then also one of the surgeons who is dealing with this. And he is the most hardworking surgeon. At one point, he is on his feet for 8 days straight, and she is the one who is evaluating him and administering vitamins into him, speed into him, making sure he eats enough. And he just is a machine, and he's powering through this entire time, but he's the most talented surgeon there. And she is the most talented psychiatrist, and she's having to deal with not only the men who are injured, who have lost their lives, lost limbs, but also dealing with the surgeons who have to treat these men and choose who they're going to treat. This whole book is so intense. You're in the middle of a war, in the middle of a war zone, dealing with super intense life and death, gritty, grisly situations, and then there's this intense romance woven into it. I felt like when my heart was racing the entire time I was reading it. All of these books are super short, by the way, so very easy to get through. And I have to give C.D. Race props. She's such a beautiful writer. She's considered the Shakespeare of smut, which I think is amazing. So her steamy scenes are super, super steamy. Super well written too. But also, she had to have done a lot of research because it felt like, and I'm not a psychiatrist and I've not been in the military, but it felt like she had done a lot of research on what both of those things are like. Once we move into like first and second book in this series, it takes on almost a romantic suspense, which I haven't really read before, but this one is very good. So I'm excited to move on in that series. All right, guys, that's it. That is every book that I read in May. I'm sorry, I'm sure this was 8,000 years long. I'm losing my voice. Let me know down below if you have read any of these books and what you thought about them. And as always, happy reading.